An ancient and monstrous lord amongst vampires, Ushoran is one of the most dreaded of Nagash's Mortarch servants. Hello there. We've got a really special video for you. We're going to show you how to fully paint Ushoran so he looks awesome as a centerpiece for your Flesh Eater Court army. This is such a cool and monstrous mini that we absolutely cannot wait to get cracking on. The paints we'll be using are on the screen right now. These colors include all of the highlighting for the various elements of the model. As you can see, there are a few more paints than normal. Ushoran is a big centerpiece, but we've tried to reuse as many of the paints as we can throughout the various stages of the painting process. We've used loads of muted colors in order to really tie into the horrific and ghoulish feel of Ushoran. We also have a list of the additional equipment we've used, but you can use whatever brushes you feel most comfortable with. If you're new to painting or want to brush up on your skills, you can check out the Citadel Color Painting Essentials videos to learn all about our paints and painting techniques. We've sprayed our model with Wraithbone spray to give us a nice light and warm base coat to work from. We have also split our model into two sub-assemblies, with the base detail on one and Ushoran himself on the other, just to make it easier to get to those tricky bits while painting. Let's crack on. The first thing that we're going to paint is the red cloak. This is because it will be tricky to paint the underside of it later because it is obscured by other details. We need to load up our medium shade brush with Flesh Terror's Red and apply it in a controlled fashion over the cloak. When using contrast, we want to paint in sections and slowly move our way around the area. This helps to reduce brush and tide marks on the surface. Once we've completely covered the outside and inside of the cloak, we just need to look out for any pooling. Try to be neat around other details, especially the skin, because it will reduce having to tidy up with the base coat later on. We now need to apply non-oil all over the cloak. We'll be using a medium shade brush for this as well. Again, watch out for pooling and just soak it up if you find any. Once our first layer is completely dry, do another towards the bottom of the cloak. This will help to show that the cloak is more worn towards the bottom where it has dragged over the ground and muck. For our model, we've done three layers of non-oil towards the bottom of the cloak. When the second layer is done, you can do more layers if you wish. It's completely up to you. The more layers you do, the darker it will be. With the shading done, we now need to highlight the cloak. For this, we'll be using Evil Sun Scarlet and a medium layer brush. We'll thin out our paint with water and do a thick edge highlight over the raised folds and then also pick out the edge of the cloak as well. Don't worry about the inside of the cloak here, as it will be covered by the model when we reassemble it later. With that highlight complete, we're now going to push the red a little further. Right, we're going to use Wild Rider Red and a small layer brush next. We're now going to do a thin line on the most raised folds within the previous highlight. We're also going to pick out all the edges of the cloak. By painting within the lines of the previous highlight, we're helping to show that nice transition of color towards the brighter areas where the light would naturally pick it out. We'll take our time with this step in order to control the process. If we do make a mistake, all we need to do is just tidy up with the previous colors. For our final step of the highlights, we're using Cadian Fleshstone as a dot highlight on the very raised areas. We'll use a small layer brush for this as well. We're using Cadian Fleshstone because it is more muted than going with oranges and yellows as our final highlight. We don't want the cloak to read as too bright, so this will help to tie it in with the rest of the model later on. With that complete, our highlights are done. Now to add some grime. In this next step, we're going to cover the inside and bottom of the cloak with Mortarian grime. We're using a medium shade brush here. Do as many layers as needed to get that dulled, grimy look. Just remember to let the previous layer dry before doing another one and to watch out for pooling. A good tip here is while this step is drying, we can start to tidy up the skin areas with Wraithbone, as we'll need a nice clean surface to work from when doing the skin. We've done four layers of Mortarian grime over the inside and bottom of the cloak. Now it's time to tackle the skin.
The first thing we're going to do is use Nighthaunt Gloom and thin it out with contrast medium to a 1-to-1 ratio and apply it all over the skin. We'll use a small base brush for this. We've thinned with contrast medium here as we want the base coat to do some work for us with some subtle highlighting. This is because the contrast will naturally pull away from the raised areas. Nighthaunt Gloom is very pigmented and gives a flat finish, so contrast medium thins it and helps with the natural highlights that we want. It'll also help us to control the process more by thinning the paint and thus reducing the risk of texturing when we do further layers. Using what we've learned from doing the cloak, we'll tackle the skin in sections and flooding the area with a loaded brush, remembering to go back and soak up any excess or pooling with dry bristles. Once the paint is dry, apply another layer at the same 1-to-1 ratio. This will help to get good coverage over the skin and to give it a nice, smooth finish. Okay, with the base layer established, we now need to do that nice light green tone that we can see on his hands, knees, and face. In order to do this, we'll be slowly building up the color with thin layers of Krieg khaki and a medium layer brush. We need to thin out the paint quite a lot here, almost a 2-to-1 ratio with water. Before we apply it to the model, we'll just check it out on our palette, because if it's too thin, it will just run off into the recesses. We're thinning the paint like this because it will give us that nice translucent finish as we build up each successive layer without the risk of adding unwanted texture. Let the layer dry before doing another. A good tip when doing the fingers and toes or any raised feature is to brush towards the ends of them because that will make it the lightest. This is because the most amount of pigment is left where you raise your brush. We now need to shade our skin, and for this we'll use Nuln Oil and apply it with a medium layer brush. We're going to paint into the recesses of all the features and muscles in order to add a bit more definition. Try to be as neat as possible. If we do overspill, we'll quickly soak it up with the dry bristles. If we do make a bit too much mess, we can always tidy up with Wraithbone and reapply the Nighthaunt Gloom. It's time to highlight the skin, and we're going to do it in two ways here. We'll be using Deepkin Flesh and a small layer brush for our highlights. Deepkin Flesh is perfect for this as it has a greenish yellow hue, so will work nicely over the green and darker blue toned skin. Pick out the raised areas of both the lighter and darker skin to tie them together. For the lighter green, traditional layer highlights will work nicely here. We're not looking for hard edge lines, so thin out your mix a bit more than normal in order to make sure it's not too opaque. Then build up the highlight with layers over the raised areas. For the darker skin tone, we don't want to thin out Deepkin Flesh as much because we're going to use it to pick out all the bumps, tears, muscle fibers, and tendons that we can find. The sculpt is full of them, so take your time going around each area picking them out. This type of highlight is a quick way to make the darker skin look aged, worn, and unhealthy. It also benefits from using the contrast paint base layer that we did to do our work for us with the volumetric highlighting already in place. With that stage complete, there is just one more paint to go on the skin. For our last paint on the skin, we'll use Pallid Witch Flesh and a small layer brush to pick out the most prominent raised skin around the face, knuckles, knees, toes, and elbows. Again, thin out the paint a bit more than normal to avoid any hard lines. We want to be very subtle with this paint because it will be too overpowering if we add too much. So just focus it on the very raised areas and try to use the tip of your brush where you can to keep the highlight nice and concise. And there we go, our skin is complete. We're now going to add a bit of color variation to some areas. We can see that Ushoran has these angry and sore looking wounds across his skin and mouth. In order to do this, we're going to use a 1-to-1 ratio of Volupus Pink and Contrast Medium on these areas. We'll use a medium layer brush for this. We don't want to overload our brush too much, as we want to have good control as we go around these areas and apply it to exactly where we want it. The first layer will be quite transparent, so just use it to map out where we want to stain the skin. We'll then let it dry before doing more layers to build up the color. A good tip here is the closer towards the wound we go, add more depth of color there to emphasize where most of the blood or bruising would be. We can also put pure Volupus Pink into the deepest recesses and mouth just to nail that look in. With that stage complete, the skin looks suitably bruised and organic. We'll pick out the eyes next, and for this we're going to use Iron Jaws Yellow and a small layer brush. Iron Jaws Yellow is a dirty and sickly looking yellow, so it's perfect for Ushoran. We're going to apply it straight from the pot over his eyes. Don't worry too much about staining the surrounding area, as this will help to make the eyes look like they are glowing a bit, which is perfect for us. With that done, we're going to push the glow a bit further with one more paint. In order to really make our eyes pop, we'll be applying Dawn Yellow into the center of the eyes with a small layer brush. Dawn Yellow is a very light and bright yellow that will sit nicely over Iron Jaws Yellow and help to make Ushran's eyes really stand out for us. When doing eyes, a good tip is to hold our breath, if we can, to help steady our hand when applying the paint. With that complete, it's time to move on to doing his armor. We need to pick out the plate armor, mace, bracelets, goblet, and necklace with Runelord Brass. We'll use a small base brush for this. Thin out the metallics with a bit of water to stop it from being too thick and goopy when applying it. Be careful when painting the armor near painted details. If we make a mistake, we'll just need to tidy back up with the respective colors. Next, we're using Retributor armor to pick out the Stormcast Eternal helmet and a couple of bracelets on Ushoran's wrists. Finally, we're using Iron Warriors with a medium layer brush to pick out the chainmail and other metal objects that we can find on the model. Just check the box art if you're confused as to where these are. Again, be careful around previously painted details. With that complete, it's time to shade our metallics. So, to shade our metallics, we'll be using a few different shade paints. Firstly, we're going to shade all over the bronze and gold metallics with Seraphim Sepia and a medium shade brush for the larger areas, and then moving to a medium layer brush for the smaller areas in order to be neater. Remember to watch out for pooling when doing this all over shade. While that is drying, we'll shade the silver metallics with non-oil and a medium layer brush. Be careful around other details with non-oil, especially the skin. When we're finished with that step, and the Seraphim Sepia stage has dried, we'll be doing a recess shade for the bronze and gold details with Agrax Earthshade. We're going to use a small layer brush for the step to help control the paint. With that complete, the shading stage is done. Now for highlighting. We're going to focus on the brass and gold details first, so we need to re-establish the brass base layer with thin Runelord brass and a medium layer brush, leaving the shading towards the recesses. We're focusing the paint towards the edges and center of the large plate sections. If we overdo it, we can always just tidy back up with the shading steps. When that is done, we'll do the gold details with thinned Retributor armor, picking out the raised details of the bracelets and Stormcast Eternal helmet. With the brass and gold buffed up again, let's add some sharper highlights. We're going to use Canoptic Alloy and a small layer brush to pick out the edges of all the brass details. Canoptic Alloy is quite thin already, as it is a layer paint, so just add a little bit of water to make sure that it flows nicely off your brush. When edge highlighting metallics, we want to really emphasize that the surface is hard and sharp, so we're going to try and keep our line small along the edges. There are some good tips to remember when edge highlighting. One of them is to always try and brush towards yourself, because this will help you to control the paintbrush. Another is to not apply too much pressure through your brush onto the surface, and just take your time when doing it. With the brass details picked out, we now need to do the gold and silver. For our next highlight, we're using Runefang Steel and a small layer brush. We're going to gently glide our brush over the raised links of the chainmail. Don't worry about picking out each individual chain. We'll just drag the brush down towards ourselves, letting the bristles do all of the work. Once that is done, we need to pick out the edges of the Stormcast Eternal helmet and gold bracelets as well. And there we go, our metallics are all highlighted. We now need to clean out our water pot, as we don't want any metallic flakes in the rest of our paints. If we look at the box art, we can see that the metallics have some weathering on them. So we're going to focus on the brass and gold details first and add some oxidation to them. To do this, we're going to use Nihilac Oxide, thinned with water around the rivets and recesses. We'll use a small layer brush here for control. Once that's dry, we'll then use pure Nihilac Oxide into the deepest recesses that we can find. With that complete, we're now going to add some rust to the silver details. Alright, for the rust, we've got a really cool trick to get the rust done nicely and easily. We're going to thin out Scrag Brown with water to a shade consistency and wash it over patches of the chainmail for a rusty and dirty look. We're using a medium layer brush for this. We're focusing these patches towards the bottom and sides of the chainmail. Once that is dried, we'll then thin out Troll Slayer Orange, but not to the same extent as our Scrag Brown step, and apply that in small sections within the previous step. We'll use a small layer brush here. A less is more approach is perfect with Troll Slayer Orange, as too much of it will be overpowering. With that complete, the metallic section is done and looks awesome. We're going to focus on the black details next, and for this we'll be using Black Templar straight from the pot. We're going to pick out his nails with a small layer brush and then the rope and leather straps with a medium layer brush. Black Templar is a perfect paint for this because it has a slight blue tone that fits with the skin and isn't too stark. Because it is a dark contrast paint, just be careful near the skin as it will stain it a lot and we'll need to tidy back up from the start of the base coat to fix any errors. Right, with those details picked out, we're now going to highlight them. For the rope and leather straps, we're going to stipple highlight them with Skaven Blight Dinge and a small layer brush. We're stipple highlighting here as it will help to sell the idea that the leather and rope are worn and used by giving them a scratchy, uneven finish. When stippling, we'll try to use the tip of our brush to keep the scratches and dots small and in proportion with the model. Too big and it will look unnatural on the surface. Once we're happy with that step, we'll then use Administratum Grey to pick out the most raised areas and add more definition to the leather and rope. Again, we're using a small layer brush for this. We now need to pick out the nails. We want the black here to look different from the rope and leather, so we've decided to use Fenrisian Grey and a small layer brush to edge highlight them. The blue tone helps to tie them in with the skin nicely. Fenrisian Grey is quite bright already, so we'll try to keep our line nice and small to stop us from overpowering the area. Once that is done, we'll do a dot highlight on the tops of the highest areas with Blue Horror and a small layer brush. For the dot highlight, just use the very tip of your brush. Alright, we're really starting to make our way through Ushoran now. Let's do the fur coat next. As we can see on the box art, Ushran's fur cloak has two different main colours. These are brown and grey. We're going to tackle the grey fur first. We'll do this by applying Basilicanum Grey straight from the pot over the fur, watching out for the middle area that will be a brown colour. We can always check the box art to help us out as to where these are. Once that is dry, we'll just check back over the grey fur and fill in any areas that we've missed or need a second coat with Basilicanum Grey. With that step complete, we now need to highlight the grey fur. We want a rough and worn looking grey that isn't too bright. It so happens that Storm Vermin Fur is a perfect choice for this. We're going to use a medium dry brush here to pick out all of the grey fur. Just be careful when going near previously painted details. If you want to know more about dry brushing, you can always go check out our Painting Essentials videos all about it. Alright, with that dry brush complete, we're going to move to doing the brown fur. For this, we'll be using Gore Grunter Fur and a small base brush. Also, we purposely haven't tidied up the overspill from the grey fur on the Wraithbone base coat. This is because when we apply the Gore Grunter Fur contrast, it'll look like darker patches and break up the uniformity nicely. Again, once it is dry, we'll give this area the once over to make sure we haven't missed anything or if we need to do another layer. We now need to add a bit more depth to the brown fur, and for this we'll use Agrax Earthshade to wash all over it. We're using a small base brush for this. We're going to focus a bit here and try to keep away from the grey fur areas. With that complete, we now need to highlight it. We're going to pick out the brown fur with Scrag Brown and a small dry brush. Try to be neat here, but don't worry too much if a little goes on the grey. This will help to merge the two together nicely. We'll now pick out the brown fur with a much lighter dry brush of Baneblade Brown, again using a small dry brush. We're looking to just hit the tips and most raised areas. Again, don't worry too much if we get some on the grey fur. Finally, we'll do a very light dry brush of Grey Sear across both the grey and brown fur to tie it together. Grey sear is very light, so we need to be careful on the brown fur, especially as we don't want to destroy our previous highlights. Remember that it's always easier to add more than it is to clean up if we've done too much. With that complete, our fur is done. We're now going to use grey sear again with a small layer brush to pick out the hair on Ushran's head, as well as the hair across all the unfortunate heads within his cloak. We need to shade Ushran's hair as well as the hair on the severed heads, and for this we'll be using Soulbite Grey and a medium layer brush. Just be careful around previous details and look out for pooling. Nice and simple step next, we're using White Scar to layer over the raised details of the hair. We've also focused the paint more towards the bottom of the hair as well, so we can get that nice easy gradient of darker hair on the heads and then lighter towards the tips. We now need to pick out all of the decayed, plagued, and dead skin that we can find on the heads within the cloak. We're going to do this with two shades to help speed up the process. Firstly, we're going to use Mortarian Grime and a medium layer brush to wash all over the skin. As always, watch out for pooling when doing this step, as we don't want to obscure details. Once that is dry, we're then going to recess shade with Croak Green and a small layer brush. These green tones work really well together and look great. We've decided to do this with all the heads, as it just ties them together nicely, as well as saves us a bit of time during the painting process. However, if you are keen to paint each head in a different skin tone, then you can always check out this tutorial on skin tones to help you with your process. We're going to add some very minimal highlights to the skin, and for this we're using Deepkin Flesh and a small layer brush to pick out the raised details. We'll add a bit of water to thin out the paint, as we don't want it to be too stark and allow it to flow nicely off our brush. With that done, the decayed, plagued, and dead skin looks suitably horrid. We'll now use Wraithbone to tidy up all of the skulls, bones, and teeth that we can find on Ushoran. This includes the ones coming out of his forehead and elbows. Grisly stuff there. We've got a lot of painted areas around these details, so we'll need to be careful and take our time with this step. So in order to help us, we'll be doing this with a small layer brush. Once that is complete, we're going to apply Skeleton Horde straight from the pot all over these areas using a medium layer brush. Wait for the first layer to dry on the crown and elbow spikes, and then do a second towards the bottom where the spikes meet the skin. This will give a cool color transition. Don't forget to pick out the teeth as well. All right, with that stage done, we're now going to layer over the raised areas of the skulls and teeth with Ushabti Bone and a small layer brush. However, for the crown of bones and the bones coming out of his elbows, we're going to edge highlight along those ridges that we can see leading to the sharp tips. Remember to add a bit of water to thin out Ushabti Bone, as we don't want it too thick and goopy. We're now going to do a fine edge highlight of Screaming Skull on the raised details of the skulls, any edges that we can see, as well as towards the tips of the teeth. We're using a small layer brush here as well. With the crown of bones and the elbow spikes, we'll edge within the previous layer towards the tips. We're pulling the pigment up towards the tips as well, as this will push the contrast more and make them look sharp. Nice! The skulls, bones, and teeth are done. We're now going to add a bit of flavor to the rotted skin of the severed heads. For this, we're going to use the same Volupus Pink recipe that we did on Ushran's face and wounds. So that is going to be a 1-to-1 ratio of Volupus Pink to contrast medium, and apply it over the eyes, mouth, and any wounds that we can see on the heads and bits of skin in his cloak. This is a very quick step, but it is a massive payoff in looking cool and part of the rest of the model. With that previous step done, we're going to pick out the eyes with Iron Jaws Yellow straight from the pot and with a small layer brush. This will sit nicely on top of the Volupus Pink and really give the eyes that final touch of a bloodied and rotting look. Don't forget to pick out the eyes on the beasts on his cloak. We now need to go back over and pick out all of the rest of the silver metallic details on the fur cloak. We didn't do this earlier, as there were many layers of dry brush stages to do, and we didn't want to clog the details with too much paint by having to tidy back up. We're doing the exact same silver recipe that we did earlier on these details. So if you're confused as what to do, just go check that out. With the final silver details picked out, we now need to do the rotted leather sections of the cloak. We're going to carefully base these areas with Death Corpse Drab and a medium layer brush. Apply a bit of water to your mix in order to thin it out and allow it to run smoothly off your brush, making sure to go slowly around previously painted details. We'll need to do a few layers of this to get good coverage, so just remember to let the first layer dry completely before coming back over with the next layer. Once that base layer is complete, we're going to wash the entire area with Agrax Earthshade and a medium layer brush. When that has dried, do another directly into the recesses to really push the contrast more. As always, watch out for pooling and getting it onto the previously painted details. We're now going to relayer over the raised areas with Death Corpse Drab again with a medium layer brush. We'll leave the Agrax Earthshade step in the recesses. Once that is done, use thin Strachan Green to push it even more. Focus on the raised areas and edges. When that is done, and for the larger flat areas, we can come back to add some texturing by using the tip of our brush and brushing in multiple directions, waiting for it to dry and then doing more. For this step, we'll use a small layer brush. Try to keep these strokes as thin as possible, as it will help to make it look like scratches in the leather. This is a cool and easy way of adding texturing and interest to larger flat areas. For our final highlight on the rotted leather, we're going to stipple Ushabti bone over the edges and add some scratches here and there to them. Ushabti bone is a lot brighter than the previous paints, so we must try to do small lines and scratches where we can. This will show where the leather has worn away the most, because when leather wears and is used, it goes lighter. And with that completed, our rotten green leather is done. All right, we're going to do the red gemstones next. And in order to do this, we just need to base them with Runefang steel and a small layer brush first. Be careful around the previously painted details. Once that is done, thin Flesh Terrors Red to a 1-to-1 ratio with contrast medium and layer over the previous step, watching out for pooling. If needed, you can always do a second layer of Flesh Terrors Red just to make it a bit darker. We're now going to edge highlight the gemstones with Wild Rider Red and a small layer brush. Take your time doing this. If you make a mistake, just go back over with the previous colors. Once that is done, we'll then do a fine edge highlight with White Scar for that high contrast shine look. Make sure to paint within the lines of the previous step. And there we go, our gemstones are completed. Right, Ushoran is now fully painted, so we're going to move on to doing the base next. This shouldn't take too long, and we're super excited to get it completed. The first thing we're going to do is completely cover all of the cobbles with Storm Vermin Fur and an extra large base brush. Thin out Storm Vermin Fur with a bit of water to make sure that it's not too thick and goopy when applying it onto the base. We're going to need a few coats of this, so let the first one dry completely before moving on to the next. We'll change to a medium shade brush when going near some of the other details on the base. We're using Storm Vermin Fur for a base layer here, as it is a warm grey that contrasts nicely against Ushoran and sets us up for the next paint. Okay, with the cobbles based, we now need to do that awesome warm red tone all over them that we can see on the box art. In order to do this, we're going to thin out Blood Reaver Flesh to a wash consistency with Lamium Medium and use a medium shade brush. Get a couple of large dollops of Blood Reaver Flesh onto your palette. Wash your brush and then get 5 dollops of Lamium Medium. Mix the two together to make your wash of Blood Reaver Flesh. Apply this mix all over the cobbled base area. Allow it to dry fully and watch out for pooling. Once dry, apply again, focusing further down the columns, recesses, and bottoms of the steps. This will help to create that light to dark red tone transition that we can see on the box art. Once dry, do a final layer, just focusing into the recesses. While we wait for that to dry fully, we're going to pick out the sculpted dirt patches with Basilicanum Grey straight from the pot and a medium layer brush. Don't worry too much if there's any Blood Reaver Flesh on the sculpted dirt, as the Basilicanum Grey will cover over nicely. Do a second layer if needed and allow it to dry fully before moving on to the next step of the dirt. The Blood Reaver Flesh wash should be fully dry now, so we're going to add some depth to the recesses of the bricks with non-oil and a medium and small layer brush. Use the medium layer brush for any of the bigger areas and sway to the smaller one when doing the finer recesses. Non-oil just helps to push the contrast more and add some good depth to the cobbles. With that completed, we just need to highlight next. For our highlight, we're going to do a simple dry brush of Screaming Skull over the entire base, both the cobbles and the dirt patches. A dry brush works perfectly here as it will give the stone that natural finish. Remember not to press too hard when doing this dry brush, as we don't want any streaks across the stonework. And with that done, our stone and dirt is completed. All of the other details, the skeletons, the bones, the rusty metal that we can find on the base, we have already painted on Ushoran. So for those particular details, just watch how we did them for Ushoran and then do it again here. And there we go. Our Ushoran is complete and ready to lead his army against all those who oppose them. We've had a lot of fun with this painting project, and we hope that inspires you to push yourself when you paint your Ushoran as well. For more tutorials, tips, and tricks, check out our videos on the Warhammer YouTube channel, or you can head to your local Warhammer store where our amazing staff will be more than happy to help. Well, we hope you've enjoyed this video, and we'll see you again soon. Bye-bye.